to share briefly in the times that we have on what the resurrection means to me. You know, every year on Easter Sunday, we often teach on the resurrection, and we bring evidences and proofs of the resurrections, and we preach apologetics messages and all this. But today I have in my heart to share something more personal, and at the same time I can challenge your faith. All of us who have been Christian for a while, even a short time, and we have read the Bible, we all know the wonderful chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Yes? Yes. And we know what this 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is about? 15, not 12 or 13 or 14. The resurrection. Yes. Okay. Okay. You need to review your New Testament. Yes. Oh, that was a good test. Yeah. I was sure everybody will shout, the resurrection. Yes. The greatest chapter on the resurrection ever. And this chapter ends with an application. This is really amazing. When you look at this, you wonder, why is this application, the very last verse of such a glorious chapter? And 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, I think you have it here with me. Therefore, this is the conclusion of this wonderful, Paul in this chapter is really bringing proofs of the resurrections, is attesting to the resurrection, is giving us arguments. If there is no resurrection of Christ, what kind of life we would have, like a miserable life, no hope, no forgiveness of sin. And then he finished with the most wonderful declaration of victory. And then this verse comes at the very end. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that the Lord and the Lord your labor is not in vain. What does that mean to me to have such a strong application? Like we look at the resurrections of the glory to come, where the mortal will be clothed with immortality, and then we come back to the reality of our daily life with this application like this. Be steadfast. Don't let anything move you. Just continue in the work of the Lord. Just go on with your life and serve the Lord with all of your heart, because we know that the triumph of Jesus Christ, we know that the resurrection of Jesus Christ, if we live it out in our lives, will result in rewards for our lives. Whatever you are doing in the Lord, because you believe in Jesus Christ, you have received the power of the resurrection in your life, you are serving the Lord with your life, you have given yourself over to the Lord, there will be a reward. Nothing is in vain in the Lord. Little things, big things. Actually, the Lord reversed the order of things in the gospel when he says, if you want to be great, what you need to do? You need to make yourself small. And there's a call to humility, to serve one another, to yield to other people, and all of this. So there's this wonderful application here, because we know something about the resurrection. And the New Testament always points to the resurrection as the primary cause of transformation. When the resurrection took place, then our lives are being transformed. And you know, there are many evidence of the resurrections in the Bible, but I think the most evident to me is the transformations of the apostles of Jesus Christ. You look at their lives before the resurrection and after the resurrection, and these are completely different people. And the strongest testimony to the resurrection of the Lord today and today's generation is your transformed lives. This no one can argue with that. We can argue with biblical, is the Bible true? Is this proof acceptable? Is this a historical fact? We can turn blue in arguments with one another, but nobody can argue with your transformation, with what Jesus Christ has done in your life. We cannot argue with that. You look at the book of Acts, you know, these apostles were from fear to boldness to proclaim, and they even went to martyrdom. So you don't go to martyrdom unless you have strong evidence of something and you really stand upon something solid. Otherwise, you will just back off. You will not go that far. You know, when you read in Romans chapter 6 on baptism, you have a picture of death to the old life and this newness of life. Again, the resurrection is this cutting off between the old life that was controlling our lives in sin and this newness of life, this new freedom that we have in Jesus Christ. I have experienced that. When I was before Jesus Christ, I was really radical, living for the devil in sin. And when I received Jesus Christ and I tasted the power of the resurrection, I became radical for Jesus Christ. From radical for the devil to radical for Jesus Christ. And I think for those of you have a similar experience. So this morning I want to look at the effect of the resurrection in my life and in your life, and what it means to be me and you. In the next slide, I have written some words that I want to discuss with you this morning. What we find in the resurrections, in the resurrection we find energizer, we find Christ living in me, we find the fulfillment of God's love, we find drawing power from Christ Jesus, sense of completions, calming our restlessness, and our victory, and fully alive. So these are some of the words that I want to look at with you this morning. Hallelujah. And the first one I want to look at is the fulfillment of God's love. You know, the resurrection is a promise of eternal life. Okay, we know that, eternity with God. But actually, it's more than that, because it is being lived out now. Eternal life starts from the day you receive Jesus Christ in your heart, the King of life. You believe, you say yes to the resurrection. So this promise of eternity is already part of your life right now. And that is something to realize. It is the fulfillment of God's love now in your life. And the key word for you this morning to remember is the word now. The resurrection power is now. It fulfilled God's love in you. You know, God always wanted you and me to live for Him, to be with Him, to be in communion with Him, and sin broke that relationship. Okay, so God wanted us to be with Him now, but He wants us to live with Him right now. And that is what the resurrection makes possible to now. And also the resurrection answers the imagination of man. You know, when you think about life and death, like for instance, the tragic event that I just mentioned this morning in the family in the Philippines, a lot of questions will come to mind. There will be questions about, is there life after death? How is it like? Will I be there? Am I right with God? Am I ready for eternity? Is there an eternity? What is it like, heaven and hell and all this? And we have the imagination of man that can go to any directions. We have all sorts of philosophy, all sorts of concepts and ideology. But the resurrection of Jesus Christ answers the searches of man's imagination. It tells us what it is. It tells us exactly what it is. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is God's response to the questions and the searching of man's imagination for the truth and for the life to come. There's a scripture here that says, I am not the one living now. It is Christ living in me. I still live in this body, but I live by faith in the Son of God. He is the one who loved me and gave Himself to save me. It is the fulfillment. From all eternity, God had a plan to, because of His love, to save you, and the resurrection attests to it, and it makes it possible. So the resurrection is the fulfillment of God's love to you. You can live your life with God as God intended for you right now. From the moment you believe in Jesus, you can live with God, for God. You can be in communion with Him, taste of His love and everything. It's a new journey. And the hope and the resurrection should be expressed every day that you live. There should be an expression. Another effect of the resurrection is that we become fully alive. You know, and John chapter 10, verse 10 says, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. But I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. When disastrous event, accident, tragedy happens, most people, we experience all sorts of negative emotions, fear, depression, anger, also, and many times it will lead to wasted years. People are afraid, they go to depressions, they may even commit suicide, turn to drugs, alcohols, like all sorts of things, and even turn out into a psychiatric ward and all of this. I don't know if you have ever visited people in psychiatric ward, but that's quite an experience. It's a very traumatic experience. It's a very shocking. You see what the devil can do, how the devil can destroy your life and make someone's really like possessed, you know, losing total hope. And it is an horrible experience to go there. And you need to go with the power of God when you go into these kind of things. In psychiatry, they use a word, a trauma. And it says that, I give you a definition of trauma. A psychological shock or severe distress from experiencing a disastrous event outside of the range of usual experience, like something really extreme, like rape, military combat, like horrible circumstances. And many times a trauma will follow, where people will lose something from their mind, like it will destroy their personality, because they will be so under that event that their mind will, or their emotion is unable to cope with that, to come back or to face the events, and it will affect them and they will be in a trauma. And we see that this is the work of the devil. This is really the work of the devil. The thief comes to steal and kill and destroy. People turn to alcohol, murder, and go to psychiatric ward. But the resurrection of Jesus Christ produces a totally different effect. It changes that. When you believe in Jesus Christ, you become fully alive. Jesus talks of a life more abundant, like a full life. And this can only begin with the resurrection. The resurrection of Jesus Christ, when you have it, it helps people to overcome like trauma. It helps people to face life difficulties. It lifts up people to confront life's most difficult problems, even with assurance. There's hope. There's expectation. This can be fixed. This can be changed. I am not going to remain a victim for the rest of my life. God is on my side. God has the power to change. The resurrection of Jesus Christ produces what I will call the word grace. It produces grace, and it can even bring something beautiful out of the most miserable circumstance. And that is what something the power of the resurrection can do. That is something that we need in our lives. The power of the resurrection can turn any negative circumstance, the worst of them, and turn them into something beautiful. It can produce something. Have you had any of these experiences? Are you facing experience like this? Let Jesus' life bring full life into your life. That's what it means. This make you fully alive. This is a miracle. The resurrection of Jesus Christ produced this miracle in us. We can face tomorrow. And this is one of the songs. Another thing is a sense of completion. The resurrection of Jesus Christ allows us to hope for what we missed in our life. You know, all of us, we miss something. We compare, we look at what other people have, or we look at ourselves in our own lacks, in our own weaknesses, areas of weaknesses, and we realize that we miss. As we live and we grow older, we accumulate mistakes and regrets. Or am I the only one? When I talk with my mother, she's 87, she often come back on that subject of things that she regrets, things that she would do differently. I mean, she believes in Jesus, she reads the Bible, but the memory of these things still are there. And myself, I have. And we often hear people say, if I could go back younger, if I could start over, if I could do it again, maybe you have it. But the Bible talks that in Christ Jesus, in the faith, for the righteous men and women, when we have been justified by Jesus Christ, that we have access to spiritual treasures, spiritual riches that we need to help us live well or live better, like the full life of Jesus Christ. And in Proverbs, we have, I just picked two of them because there are so many scriptures. It says the reward for humility and fear of the Lord is what? Riches and honor and life. These are results of the resurrections, of a full life, of what God brings into our life. We have in our lives access to all sorts of spiritual strength, results, honor, something that will bring honor, something that is good, something that is noble, and a better life, something better than without it. By knowledge, the rooms are filled with all precious and pleasant riches. Aren't you blessed that you have a God in your life? You have access to that. You can live that kind of life, and you have it. The resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us the opportunity to finish everything well. That's the completion, the hope of the completion. I don't know, if you look at yourself, like I look at myself, I wonder, how can God make me perfect or ready for heaven? Of course, I know that by faith I have been justified. But I look at my lacks. I look at my weaknesses. I'm aware in my human body, in my personality, that I'm far from being perfect. But I have a sense of completion in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It will finish well. I will complete what God has started in my life. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, this is one of the most comforting and reassuring scriptures in the Bible. It brings the incompleteness of our life to completeness. And what is not full to be full. The word complete or perfect or mature is used a lot in the New Testament because that's a result of the resurrection. When you come to Jesus Christ, we are broken vessels. We have been messing up our lives. We have been living without the treasures and the riches of Christ. And we need to learn how to live the life of Jesus Christ. But then you look at the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it points at the end, and it says to you, God will complete. God has plans for your life. We all know that. We know the scriptures in Jeremiah. God knows the plan that I have for you, plans, you know, to give you hope in the future, not to harm you, and all of this. We know these things. We know these things. God created each one of us with a good purpose. But the thing is that with the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we can fulfill the good purpose of God. We don't have to go erring away and just like without purpose, without aim, or without direction. Truly, the Apostle Paul says that he was aiming at the end. You can see the end of the line. You can see the goal at the end. And it's all because of the resurrections. Do you regret something in your life from your past? Probably you do. That can be a divorce, bad decision, hurting someone, having been hurt, or because you have neglected people that you should have taken care of, or failures in your life. The Bible says you can redeem the time. That is what you have in the resurrection of Jesus Christ also, the promise of time. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15. See then that you walk circumspectly. Not as fool, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. The resurrection of Jesus Christ enables you and me to finish well, to redeem the time. You know, I know that the devil stole away from me at least 9 years of my life. when I started to take drugs and I became another person, and I when I look back to these years, he has stolen, you know, my personality, my goals, the purposes of God, and I have done things that I am ashamed of. This is what the devil took away from me. But when I became a Christian, I realized I can redeem the time. I can live fully for God. I can use my life, and God will bless it and everything. I determined that I would live fully and redeem the life that God has given me to live, and to complete it well. That's the hope of the resurrection. We have a sense of completions. I know where I'm going, and I know how I want to live for the Lord Jesus Christ. Another result is that the resurrection of Jesus Christ also calm our restlessness. This is a part of our humanity. You know, in a way of speaking, the resurrection of Jesus Christ assures us of the goal has been reached. Something has been achieve. It gives us reassurance. We hear people say, I found what I was looking for. You go shopping, okay, and you find the clothes that will make you beautiful. You buy the computer that you wanted to have. You buy the appliance that will satisfy, you know, your home and all of this. You feel complete. Or you can also, I have found love. I have found the perfect match for my life, the perfect husband or the perfect wife. I have found love. I am going to be satisfied in my life. I have found the best job, the dream job of my life, good salary, good future assured. And even in the area of faith, we also say, I have found. Like myself, I often refer to my testimony and to finding Jesus Christ. And when I heard the day that I got converted, I heard this message. This preacher says, you must be born again. And when he explained what to be born again was, I really understood. I found what I had been for these last few years looking for. I found it. And Jesus says, when to the Samaritan woman, if you drink this water that I'm giving you, you will not be thirsty for any other. Isn't that like a satisfaction or something like this? But, you know, even though we have these feeling of satisfaction at times, like these great, joy or the most satisfying circumstance or exciting event in our life, and we feel that, I don't know if you ever had this kind of experience, like wishing that this very moment would last forever. Have you had this? I had a few of these in my life, you know. Sometimes. But there is something built in human being that makes me keep on searching for more. Even though I have had this experience of satisfaction, it doesn't last. I'm still looking for something more exciting, something that will bring. When we possess the most joy and excitement, what do? We're looking for something more. We keep on looking. We call it human restlessness. It's built in ourselves. We are just made like this. We always look for a new horizon, something more, something new. And maybe it is sin that brought this in us, or maybe it's God who has allowed us that we would be always searching for Him, something. But it's like a dissatisfaction. And maybe this is made to so that we will not become so comfortable in this earthly life, that we will always be looking for the life to come. Like we can say, this earth is not my home. I have a better home and eternity. With the resurrections, we grow into the realizations that money, jobs, earthly possessions, relationship, emotions, even the good ones, are not the greatest meaning of our lives. This is not the end. This is not the most. I'm still searching. I'm still waiting. You know, in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 34, we read about these Christians, and they are reminded of the early time after the conversion. You suffered along with those who were thrown into jail. And when you all own, and when all you own was taken from you, you accepted it with joy. You knew there were better things waiting for you that will last forever. And this is unique to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It attests to that. It brings that. That's why the resurrection of Jesus Christ calms our restlessness, or search for always something more, something. We know eventually that at the end, that in the resurrection, there is what we call these better things waiting for you, for me, that will last forever. It calms our restlessness or dissatisfactions, that even in tough times and difficult circumstances, we can be patient, we can endure long sufferings, we can go on with our life. Our home is in heaven, and the resurrection is the answer to our restlessness. You know, this resurrection power helps us to exercise self-control, sobriety, clear-headedness when it comes to our passions, our lust, our greed. Because as I said, or this restlessness, this dissatisfactions, and the perversions of sin has created in us a tremendous power of attractions that can destroy us. You can pervert positive emotions like love into sexual immorality and become a slave, and then turn out to shame or, you know, guilt and stuff like that. You can turn out, like something like ambition. Ambition is not bad. It's part of our natural personality. And to selfish ambitions and passions and greed and lust and all of this. But this resurrection of Jesus Christ calms our restlessness, and it will enable us to exercise self-restraint, self-control. That is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. Amen? So we need to have that. Another thing is that the living Christ, Jesus Christ, the living Lord, lives in me today. And the resurrection life needs to be a lived out experience, something that you must lived in action. This is the result of that. The life of Christ is not to be a mystical life or a monastic life that you will sit on the bench and you will meditate for the rest of your life to become holy and not touch anything. No. You know, when Jesus Christ called his disciples, what did he tell them? Oh, don't do anything bad. Go on the mountain, live in a cave. Don't let anybody take you. Go into a nirvana, and everything. And no, he sent them right in the crowd from the experience on the mountain. They went down in the valley. There was a demon-possessed man that has a big need. He sent them to heal the sick, to raise the dead, and to announce the good news. This is a commission. The living Christ who lives in me commissioned me, and he commissioned you to a lived out experience. We need to live that life and to glorify Jesus Christ. You know, there are different levels of this kind of experience life, okay? According to the faith that we have, according to the grace and the calling of God that we receive in our lives. We can say the entry level of that life of that we want to live out is it begins with a desire to read the Bible and go to church. You know, most of us, before we had Jesus Christ living in us, we didn't go to church. Many of us didn't go to church, or if we did, it was more like traditional ritually, like not with really a heart or something like that, a communion with God. And we were uninterested for most of the things. Or we would go to church out of traditions, but then from Monday to Saturday, then we would live like the devil or live independently or do something else. But as soon as Jesus Christ come into your life, then one of the first things that you start to feel that was not there before, you want to hear the word of God. You want to go to church. You want to open the Bible and read it, and you're discovering the riches of the word of God, the wisdom, the love of the Lord of God. You discover and you are excited. This is something new we didn't have. Do you agree that this would be normally the entry level? Yes? Okay. So what would be the next level after the entry level? Most of us, we all have that. We read the Bible, we go to church, and we know this is part of God's means of grace, and it is important for us. What is the next level? The next level usually will be a need to serve, a need to get involved, a need to participate, do something. Like before, I didn't have that. I didn't want. One of the first thing my pastor told us when we were young people in our church, he was 80-some years old, our old pastor, and he was an old Pentecostal man and very powerful, strong voice and everything. And then he would come to us, the young people, says, "Are you saved?" "Yes, yes, yes," I'm saying. "What are you saved of? Are you saved of the police?" And then, no, I'm safe of my sin. Okay, go in the park, go in the street and tell it to others. And then he would always send us to tell to someone else. And then one of the first things that I started to do, I gathered the other young people with me, and then we went to villages around our little town farming community, and we would do door to door. "Hi, may I speak to you about Jesus Christ? Would you like to hear the good news of Jesus?" And we started to evangelize. That is how we started. But before, I didn't do that. I didn't see a need of this. So at some point in our lives, we feel a desire to do something. I want to learn music. I want to sing the songs. I want to serve. I want to be an usher. I want to get involved. I want to be part of the community of Christians where God is sending me. That is a level. We move into that level. We grow into that level. This is a fruit of the Holy Spirit in our lives, the life of Jesus Christ in us. And Romans 12:6 says, "And His grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to," and then He gives us a list: prophesy, serve, encourage, teach, contribute generously, gifts of leadership, administration, acts of mercy. And we have many lists of that in the New Testament, gifts. And we are called to use these gifts for the edification of the church. That is the life of the living Jesus Christ in me that brings me into this. It has to be lived out. It has to be practiced in our lives. The book of Acts, the first thing that you see, they preached the resurrections. They were put in prison. They were arrested and threatened. "We forbid you to preach that message of the resurrection." They says, "We cannot not. We cannot not declare what we have witnessed and seen." You know, like they went into even civil disobedience. Civil disobedience is not good normally, but when it comes to the life of Christ Jesus, then sometimes we need to do things in certain closed countries, underground churches, where they are treated as criminals. We have that all over the world. You know, we are very proud of our evangelism team. We are very proud of all of you in the church who are serving the Lord, who find a place and want to do something and make a difference. Brother Stephen, always ready to when we move to two services, it is disturbing. It is going to ask a lot of us, the two services for some of us. And we hope that you are not running away from that, because it is part of our lived out life, the fruit of the resurrection. Why should I choose 9:30 service if the resurrection power is in me? Should I choose 9:30 service so that I can be free for the rest of the day? Is that my motivation? I will come early so that I have, you know, I have the rest of the day. Is that what the resurrection power is all about? Or is that, no, it gives me a greater opportunity to serve. I can go to 9:30 service. I will hear the word of God so that I will get involved in Sunday school in the second service. That's the idea of the resurrection. Not an escape to do something less. It is a call to do something more because of the resurrection power. How did you make the decisions? How are you considering the use of our time on Sundays as we move? We believe that God is leading our church to growth. We believe that by doing two services, we will be more effective. But this will be true if we all are more effective. If you say, me, it gives me a chance to sleep longer. I'm not coming to church before 11:30 so that I can do less. I will just come at 11:30, 1 o'clock, then I will go, I can sleep. Then I think you missed the point of the resurrection. Or if you say, I come to church at 9:30 so that I can be free and forget about church for the rest of the day, I think we missed about the resurrection power. Don't you think so? Yes, okay, some of you say yes, not many of you say yes, but I know you are listening. So the church provides opportunities. Okay, this is one of the mission of the church. Okay, what is one of the greatest mission of the church? To equip the saints for the work of service or ministry. This is the equipping. And the church provides opportunities of all sorts. We can be ushers, things, different things. Thank you, cleaners. For every Sundays after you have worked as a cleaner in your home and your job all week, then you are doing it here on the schedule. Thank you so much. Thank you to those who are always ready to prepare food when we have outing and everything. Thank you for those who are always doing the extra mile to bless the church with your gifts and talents for with the worship teams and others. Always rising to the next level. Always we can count on some things. And then we find among the church maybe others who are kind of not there yet. And it is more like a bit selfish or childish or immature expression, response to a challenge. You know, we can go to a mission trip. You can be called to go to a mission trip. You can say, it's not for me, and just exclude yourself. Or you can pray. Says, Lord, is it for me? And maybe the Lord will take you out of your comfort zone, where your first reaction would be to exclude yourself. Why exclude yourself first? Why not say, God, is that for me? And even though you may not see yourself on a mission trip with the church, maybe the Lord wants to bring you there so that you will learn something, so that you will expand something, so that you will be forced to grow in a certain situation. You don't know until you have given God a chance. Now, I have been asked just last week to go to Bangladesh with the underground church with another group. Now I'm praying. I talk with Pastor Jennifer. My heart is torn in two. My flesh says, yes, I want to go. My spirit says, yes, I want to go. But at the same time, if I don't go, it's not because I don't want to. It's because I would have to put it before the Lord and realize that maybe my role is in Lighthouse instead of being in Bangladesh. Okay? But that would be the Lord leading me to that. But if there is a challenge coming to me, I've never been to Bangladesh before, so I can say, no, Bangladesh is not for me. Or I can say, Lord, is that your will to go to Bangladesh for me? Can I make a difference? There are opportunities to teach. There are opportunities to meet the persecuted Christians. You know, Bangladesh is a Muslim country. So there's an opportunity for me to be in a place to learn something and also be a blessing for somebody else. Will I go? you will know in a few weeks. I haven't given my answer yet. But what I'm saying is that there is an opportunity for service. Should I go or should I not go? So I do not exclude myself from that until God will show me what to do. And you should be doing the same thing. You see your pastors. We are always going here and trying to do more and opening up doors of opportunities for the body of Christ. You have seen us for how many years, Pastor Jennifer and I? Since 1997, we worked together in this church. You see that we are always going out of our way, and we encourage evangelism and mission. We always encourage the church. We have a church that is based on volunteers. Everything is done in this church through volunteers, and this is wonderful. But you need this Sunday, Easter Sunday, to go back to the resurrection of Jesus Christ and ask yourself, what does it mean to me? And then when you decide to come on 9:30 or 11:30, decide, because you have the resurrection power of God, what will it produce in you? Less or more? Less service so that you can exclude yourself and do more things in the flesh? Or more that you can offer to God in service and in sacrifice and in devotions and in commitment? Three things that the resurrection life should be having into a characteristic of the resurrection life in you. And I have a slide for that: faith, power, and commitment. This is what your new life must show. Some characteristic of the resurrection power: faith, boldness, assurance, determination. God can use me. I can make a difference. Where do you want me, Lord? What can I do? Okay? And you know, in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 6, they were looking for men, or we can say men or women or anybody who would be fulfilling a need in the church. And they look for people with certain qualities. And what were these qualities? Faith, filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with wisdom. That is what we are looking for. The second characteristic is power. Power, confidence, all things are possible. God can achieve it. And learning to depend on God, bringing everything to prayers to God so that God's power can be active in our lives. So when you evangelize, the anointing is with you. When you pray for someone else, you have this assurance in your heart that your prayer is going to be heard. There will be healing. There will be result of your prayer. There will be comfort. People will be touched. They will cry. They will melt before the Lord. They will answer. The needs will be, all things are possible. And the third characteristic is a committed life. A committed, surrendered life. We understand the lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ. We understand servanthood. We understand that our life is meant to count and make a difference. So this morning, I just want to invite you on this Easter Sunday to reconsider your role. You reconsider your life. Reconsider all the meaning that I have brought to you this morning, and to your own decision making, and to your own role, and to whatever you want to define yourself.